following interview was conducted with Professor Virginia Ferris for the Purdue University Library's Oral History Program. It took place on Tuesday, January 16th, 2007, in her office in Whistler Hall. The interviewer is Kathering, Markee, the Oral History Librarian, and Valerie Yazza, the Diversity Fellow. Fellows. Welcome.
About where you were born, your parents and siblings.
Okay. Well, I was born in Abilene, Kansas, which is the end of the Chisholm Cattle Trail. And my parents were business people there in town, but we were surrounded by farm country, of course. I had one older brother who died fairly young. I went to school in Abilene. From grade school to junior high to high school, and just was brought up like any well-bred young miss in the Plains States in that era. Do you want to know anything? Are you interested in how I got interested in biology or any of that sort of stuff? Okay, well, I was always pretty interested in biology, and in those days, you could wander around, and we didn't worry about kidnappers or bad people lurking in the bushes. And there was a creek that ran by near my house, and so I would walk this creek endlessly in the summer months, in the spring and fall, and pick leaves and flowers and bring them home and try to figure out what they were and examine all the stuff that is around a creek. And in the Girl Scouts, I went after all the biology badges, and nobody really paid an awful lot of attention to me in those days. I mean, everybody was busy, so I just entertained myself. So I dug a pond in our backyard. Nobody really much cared about that. It was out way back in the back. And I went to the junkyard by myself and found some metal rods, and I got hold of somebody who gave me a bag of cement, and I got a bucket, and I mixed up concrete in our in this bucket, and lined my little pond with concrete and put the metal rods in, because I could read, find out all the things you had to do. The rods are to keep it from fracturing in the wintertime if it freezes. And so then I filled it with water, and I went back to my creek and snared some fish, which I brought home and put into this thing, and grew little plants in there. And of course, all this time I was reading books about this kind of stuff, and it just kind of grew naturally. And my folks gave me a tiny little microscope for Christmas one year, so I could haul out pond scum and look at it through the microscope. And I talked our family doctor into putting some harmful bacteria under a real microscope, and he showed them to me. And I thought that was pretty exciting. And so then it was pretty well settled that I was going to do something in biology when I grew up. It was all kind of self-generated. Nobody said, hey, this would be a good thing for you to do.
What was your community like?
It was a typical small town. There were a grand total of 5,000 people that lived there, if you counted every dog, cat, and chicken. And there was nothing unusual about it at all. A mother and a father and the two children, a boy and a girl. That was just about the way it was supposed to be. The men ran everything. The women pretty much cooked and cleaned took care of the household and deferred to the men. I felt something stirring within me even then, though, that didn't think that was such a great idea. Not much I could do about it in Abilene.
Were you the oldest child?
No, I was the second child, and I think that's the reason why I was allowed to wander. So, also, in those days, people had more aspirations for the boy child in the family. It was assumed that the females would just go to high school, maybe college, but get married and settle down and live around in the same neighborhood and have some children and So, I don't know, they just didn't worry too much about whether you were learning anything. who cared?
Did your brother have an interest in your...
No, not at all. Well? He was 4 years older, and he had his own things to do, but mostly he just teased me. Typical older brother.
So, and when did you finally get to take some science classes? Was it in middle school?
I guess we must have had something that passed as chemistry and biology in high school. I think even then most high schools did. I don't have any real recollection of that. I left Kansas and went to Wellesley College for my college experience. It's in Wellesley, Massachusetts. It's a women's college. And that was sort of a turning point because I found out that women could run for office and be elected. Well, we only had women, so we had to edit our papers, and, newspaper, and anything that we did. The women had to do it. And it was very competitive to get into it. And it was really funny because most people from Kansas didn't go to Wellesley College or anywhere else in the East. And so they had what probably eventually became the college entrance exams. I don't know what they call them nowadays. But anyway, there was only me out in Kansas that wanted this thing. And so they employed a school teacher in Salina, Kansas, which is 25 miles west of Abilene, to conduct this college entrance exam just for me. And the people in the East not only sent her the exam, but they sent her an alarm clock to time it with, because I guess they didn't think we had alarm clocks out there in Kansas. And so one fine day, my mother drove me to Salina, and I sat in this classroom with this little gray-haired lady in her alarm clock and took this exam for most of the day. And that was how I got into Wellesley.
How many people were in your graduating class for high school?
Oh, there weren't more than 100. I'm not even sure there were 100. Is that large or small? Maybe it was ever less. I just don't really remember. But it was not a huge class.
Were you involved in any activities?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. It's kind of faded into the background. I haven't thought about that for a long time. Nobody's really asked me about that. But there were high school clubs, and I belonged to all of them. Mm-hmm. One does. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you have any involvement in athletics?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I did, and I was pretty good in high school. Once I got to college, I couldn't compete, but I played basketball and volleyball, and I was really pretty good. I was on the team. But you have to understand, Valerie, that women's athletics was just at the very beginning, early stage. I don't think colleges generally had athletics in those early days. For women.
Oh.
They certainly did for men.
Is there any teachers who made an impact on you while you were in high school?
I have to say no. They were just teachers. I remember a lot of them, but nobody had a special impact. When I got to Wellesley College, I found teachers who had a special impact on me. Do most kids have high school teachers?
I think some do.
Do they?
Yeah. I think I had a couple, but...
Did you? The funny thing was, in my grade school, I had, as teachers in a couple of instances, people who had had my father. Isn't that crazy? So, I don't know. I actually was not a very good student in grade school, but I was fine in high school. I got all A's in high school, but my two best friends did too. Mm-hmm. So this was apparently not a particular achievement.
So how did you come to the decision to go to Wales?
You know, I just began to look around, and I realized how insulated I was from the world. There was stuff going on out there, and a lot of the U.S. history had happened in the East, but I knew a lot about Kansas history, but I just became really curious to find out how things happened in the rest of the world. And I did go 1 year to the University of Kansas because I think we were just finishing up a war, and yeah, we were World War II, and things were sort of unsettled, and my mother was a widow by that time, and she just didn't want me to go that far from home. But I discovered when I went to the University of Kansas, again, I ran into teachers who had had my parents, just like grade school, and everything in Lawrence, Kansas was very similar to Abilene, Kansas. So that pretty much settled it. I decided I was going to find out what was going on in the East. I toyed with the idea of going to California, but my mother just thought that was the end of the world, so she didn't want me to go there.
What was the campus like when you arrived
in Wellesley?
In Wellesley?
Oh my, I was sort of overwhelmed. We didn't fly places. Did you know that there was a time when people went on trains, Valerie? I bet you didn't. Did you?
I knew that.
No, I got on that train to head back to Wellesley, and I had never been any farther than Lawrence, Kansas, and here I was supposed to be getting myself on a train all the way to Massachusetts. And my grandmother at first decided that she would accompany me back. And then at the last minute, I can't remember why, she was not able to go. So I had to get on that train and go all by myself. And it stopped in Chicago, and we got off. And I guess I changed trains in Chicago. And I went to the ladies' room. And about a half hour later, I was back sitting in the waiting room, and discovered that I had left my wallet in the restroom. So I tore back, and by golly, it was sitting there right on the sink where I put it. And that was maybe the closest thing I've ever had to total disaster in my whole life. But I got back on. And we slept on those trains. We ate on those trains, and it took days, as I recall, to traverse the country by train. So when the train pulled in at Wellesley, it was pretty exciting. I mean, there were people around, and it was a little, Wellesley is, I can't remember if I went to Boston and then changed for the Wellesley train, or whether this thing went right into Wellesley. My thought is it went right to Wellesley, but I could be wrong. But anyway, when I finally got to campus, I was really impressed. Fine campus, lots of big buildings, and a whole lot of people that talk different from me. I was definitely away from Kansas. And I was meeting a new kind of competition, too, because I had not really been challenged in high school or at the University of Kansas, but I was mightily challenged at Wellesley. These were all really smart kids.
Did you live on campus?
Oh, yes. Everybody lived in dormitories in those days. I don't think anybody ever lived off campus. There was one young woman who had gotten married because her fiancé had come back from the war. And this was a total novelty, and Wellesley had a difficult time dealing with it. We had a married woman. Doesn't this all seem strange in retrospect?
Did you What kind of clubs were you involved with? Or
I didn't get involved in any of the, there were some little kind of sorority things at Wellesley, but I never belonged to one of those. I had belonged to one of, at the University of Kansas and felt like I'd been there and done that. But, so I didn't belong to any, they were not a big deal at Wellesley. Mostly I just studied at Wellesley. However, the men of MIT and Harvard were available to us, and they came out for big deals where the Wellesley girls and the guys from these Boston colleges would all kind of mingle. Nobody knew anybody, and you would dance and trade phone numbers, and it was not hard getting acquainted with people at all, men or women.
You were saying that there were some faculty members that had an impact.
Yes, there were two especially. I wanted to major in some kind of biology, and I ended up in the botany department there, and there were two really top-notch women there, and they kind of took me under their wing. One taught bacteriology, and the other one was head of the botany department, and she'd worked with a very famous botanist who eventually got a Nobel Prize for a discovery. And my teacher had been with her when she first begun to make this breakthrough, so she had lots of interesting stories to tell. She taught a good class. They did research, even at that little private college, and, which was sort of impressive, I thought. And so they really took me under their wing and encouraged me and assured me that I would be able to get an assistantship at some university eventually to do graduate work, and they gave me the courage to persevere.
Did you get to partake in any of the research that they did?
Oh yeah, oh yes, we did a lot of interesting things there. Again, it's kind of, there was another much, much older woman that worked with plants, and she had a lot of ties with Harvard botanists, and she would take us into Boston, and we'd visit the Cambridge, and we'd visit those people, and they'd show us what they were doing. Mm-hmm. I found Wellesley very exciting. Mm-hmm. Most of the girls from the East would go skiing during the mid-semester break, the between-semester break, mm-hmm. but there was a gal from Nebraska who didn't know how to ski, as I didn't, and so she and I would go to New York City and get cheap theater tickets, standing room only, and we would look at, go to plays in the afternoon and in the evening for 3 or 4 days straight. Mm-hmm. That was a lot of fun.
Like
and really quite exciting for a little gal from Abilene, Kansas.
Do you still keep in contact with anybody from?
Yes, I do. Oh yes, I exchange Christmas cards with these people with long notes.
Any faculty members?
Well, they've all died, sad to say. But, so no, I don't. But Wellesley has this, oh goodness, I can't remember what they called it. Every year they pick three alums for a special award. And these are famous people like Madeline Albright. And along about 86 or 88, I was selected as one of these people. And so I went back for all that. And then they enlarged their science building a lot. And I was on a committee to help figure out what they wanted for that. And so I went back a lot to confer with them on that topic.
Do you get to go back often?
I haven't been back for a number of years now, but during the late 80s and clear up to the mid-90s, I did go back. I was invited back a number of times to talk to students, too, about careers and science.
So did you enter graduate school right after?
Yes, I did. And I applied to University of Wisconsin, and I applied to Cornell. One of those women that I told you about was had gotten her PhD at the University of Wisconsin, and the other one had gotten hers at Cornell. And so each of those women wanted me to apply to their institution. Mm-hmm. And then there was a young woman, and I don't remember her name, but she said, you know, you better have a backup school in case you don't get into one of these two biggies. So she said, why don't you apply to Purdue? And, you know, I don't remember whether I did or whether I didn't, but wasn't that funny that I would end up at Purdue for all these years? Well, anyway, I did get accepted at both Wisconsin and Cornell with an assistantship at both places. And then those two women really, each one of them wanted me to choose theirs. And this was a very, very hard choice. And the department head, the one that I told you about, went out and I went to her institution, which was Cornell.
How did you finally...
Well, Cornell was really a very interesting experience. There were 20 of us in the class that entered that year to get either a master's degree or a PhD. There were 20 of us, and needless to say, I was the only female. And when it all shook out several years later, I think there were only about 3 people that didn't drop out or flunk out or whatever. And I was one of them. I stuck in there and got my degree. And I always thought that was pretty neat. I had a lot of, there was a lot of, I didn't find Cornell nearly as difficult as Wellesley, which I thought was kind of interesting because I was usually the only woman in any of the classes. And I had an interesting brush with real life when none of these guys ever wanted me for their lab partner. I was always the last person chosen. But usually I did better than any of them, and little by little they began to find out that being my lab partner was not all that bad. But that was uphill work. And I had a teaching assistantship, and there were all these men enrolled at Cornell who had come back on GI Bill of Rights. And I remember they would, my job was to pass out little boxes of equipment for today's lab session. And they would stand at this little window where I passed out this stuff and berate me for taking the job of a male, an able-bodied male. What are you doing here? You should not even have this job because some guy would want that job that really deserved it. You're just going to get married and have kids and drop out anyway. And so this got pretty old. I did this for 2 years. So then the National Science Foundation had instituted this new program called, what did they call that? They still have it. It's pre-doctoral fellowships. And nobody knew much about them. But nowadays, they applying for one of these things is a really big deal. You write tons of essays, and professors have to vouch for you, and I don't know what all. But in those days, we presented ourselves for one full day at a specified area on campus and just took an exam all day long. And I remember the major problem was one's bladder because you couldn't leave. And so it was an ordeal, but it was all morning, and we broke for a little while for lunch, I guess, and then all afternoon. And again, there were almost all men in there, but this is going to come as a shock to you too, Valerie, because in those days nobody gave a darn about affirmative action or anything. I mean, it's hard to believe, but nobody really cared. I mean, if you got it, you got it. If you didn't, you didn't. So, to my utter surprise, I got one of these things. And there were not very many awarded then, even as there aren't now. And it was a full ride for the rest of my PhD period. And they even offered extra money for your spouse. I believe they said for your wife. and I'll never forget this. I was taking this advanced course in plant physiology, and I told my professor about this, And he said, well, you're not going to accept that, are you? And I said, well, why not? He gave me that whole story again about how I was taking the place of an able-bodied male who would put it to much better use than I would, and that I really should decline to accept it. But I didn't. I accepted it because, I mean, the idea of a full ride and not having to do a TA, well, this was wonderful. But you know something? I did not apply for the additional money from my spouse because I was so embarrassed at even accepting the fellowship. Mm-hmm. Isn't this crazy?
That is crazy.
And that very term, he posted his grades on his door, and I was the top name on there. But even at that, he was discouraging me. You just have your mouth like you don't want to speak. Oh, your turn is coming up. Well, I think I'm telling Valerie everything I had to say. But that's the kind of stuff we ran into. And in retrospect, it hardly seems possible.
When did you get married? Was it?
My husband was one of those hapless lads that had was stuck with me for a lab partner in one of these classes. This happened to be a plant physiology class, and so we began to date during that term, and so he had been in the Army, and so he was 2 years behind me, but we got married before I got my degree, and he helped me hugely with the typing and all that. We didn't have computers. You just type this thing a million times till you got it right. And then that led to the next chapter. What was I going to do next? And you want to hear that chapter? How he finished up. Well, there I was at Cornell with this nicely brand new admitted PhD and a brand new husband. I can't remember exactly when we got married vis-a-vis when I finished. I think we got married about a year before I finished. Okay. So, the professor who ran the nematology program was going on sabbatical leave. And so they were going to have to hire somebody to take his place. He had not only ran the program there at Cornell, but there was a substation on Long Island that he ran that was doing the research on a potato cyst nematode that was very damaging to the potatoes on Long Island and had been brought in from England. Okay. So, there I was, and so they said, would you like to be an acting assistant professor and run this program while this guy's away? And we will pay you the full salary. So, I said, well, I'm going to have to think about that. I was planning hard to get in those days. Isn't it amazing, considering what I've been through? So, my husband and I talked it over, and I said, you know, if I'm going to do the work, why should I be an acting assistant professor? Why can't I just be a plain assistant professor? He said, yeah, I think that's true. Go for it. And so I went back, and I said, okay, I'll do this work, even though I don't know anything about nematology, it was a brand new discipline, and so the guy I was replacing didn't know an awful lot either. In fact, I learned what he knew in about an afternoon. He was going to go on sabbatic leave to find out what it was all about, so it wasn't hard to catch up. And so here I was, apparently able to do this, and refusing to do it unless they remove that word acting. So this dragged on for a while, and in a few days they came back and said, okay, you can just be an assistant professor. So I said, okay, fine, we'll do that. And as it turned out, that was supposed to be a one-year appointment, but I had it for almost 2 years, because even after the professor came back, I stayed on until it was time for us to leave. But do you want to hear another horrible story? During the second year, I became pregnant with my first youngster, and this was a definite no-no. So I kept it concealed under a big lab coat for 7 months, and finally, I had a little illness, and they discovered this terrible truth. And the department head called the professors together to take a vote on whether I would be allowed to go to faculty meeting in my condition. Have you ever heard of such a thing? I didn't know whether to be angry or whether to assume that, yeah, this is the way the world was. But I promised to wear my lab coat so they wouldn't have to look at it. And they finally decided I could come. But then the department head said, but the minute that baby arrives, I want a letter of resignation on my desk the very next day, or I'll have to fire you, and that won't look good on your CV. So that's what we did.
Was it right after there that you came to Purdue University?
No, it wasn't. My husband finished up, and I helped him with his thesis just the way he'd helped me. By that time, we had this youngster. And the youngster was about over a year old when it was time for us to look for a job. So the first job he got was with the Natural History Survey over in Urbana-Champaign, Illinois. So we came west and were there a couple of years. And during that time, nobody would touch me. I mean, goodness gracious. We had nepotism. Do you know what nepotism is?
Nepotism? Mm-hmm.
It's when they won't hire a husband and wife in the same department. It was supposed to have been a law. It turned out in Indiana it really wasn't a law, but the department heads used it. It was a very convenient thing to say, no, I can't hire you because of nepotism ruled. But anyway, I began to do private consulting over there in Illinois. There were some industries that had me. I was pretty good now at finding these little critters in the soil. And so people that were going to be sued because of their pesticides or whatever would have me look at the soil to determine if there were any other things in there that could be causing the trouble that they were being sued over. And then there was a USDA soybean breeder over there in Illinois who wanted me to look at his breeding plots to find out what sort of critters were in the soil because it would affect the results he got when he tested new lines of soybeans. So I had a very lucrative time working for him. He paid me, and he would collect this stuff. And we had a spare bedroom in our little house there in Urbana. So I bought a microscope with my last month's salary at Cornell and set up a little laboratory right there in the spare bedroom. And so I could look for these things. And, you know, I had this nice little thing going, and that's what I did. It was, I incorporated because of tax reasons. And eventually he got this job over here in this department, in Amon's department. And we moved over here, and I just brought my consulting business with me when I came here and set up at home. We built a house, and the first room that was finished was in the basement, and that was my laboratory. Mm-hmm. So what have we missed here?
But to kind of talk, your husband was your collaborator in the research. You know,
yes, he certainly
researchers.
Was.
Yeah, tell a little bit about some of the things.
He certainly
also,
was. We worked together for all those years and years and years and years. He was, actually when I first started there at Cornell as this assistant professor in this nematology program, he was my student because he was working on his PhD. Isn't that weird?
You had some interesting experience, which is great.
But that didn't last long, and by the time he finished up, his major professor was back on the scene. And although I still worked there, I was no longer his major professor, which was probably a good thing. when his job over over in Illinois was working with the trees. It wasn't as a nematologist, but he was trained in nematology. He actually had more training than I did. I just sort of picked mine up. But I could not have done that nematology job at Cornell if he hadn't been there, because he knew a lot more about nematodes than I did. So when we came west, and I began doing nematodes over in Illinois, he was a huge help to me over there. And there was a nematologist, an old nematologist, but very, very capable fellow, quite well known in the annals of nematology. And I went to call on him almost immediately, so he was sort of a mentor for both of us. And then my husband John got this job over here doing nematology in this entomology department. And so we worked together all the time. I mean, I hardly published a paper that he was not a co-author on, and vice versa. All our papers for years and years and years were Ferris and Ferris, and then Ferris and Ferris. We sort of all knew which of us were. In fact, soon after I got, well, maybe a year or two after I was employed here, one time my department head came boiling in to me and said, "You know something? I don't know who's doing what. Everything you write is Ferris and Ferris. Who's doing what?" So I guess that would have been an argument for keeping my maiden name. But people didn't do that in those days. At least not people who were born and reared and married in Abilene, Kansas. I don't know what my mother and my mother-in-law would have done if I tried to keep my maiden name. That was just not an option.
Has your research focus changed a little bit, or?
Oh, it's changed hugely over the years.
Share that for the researchers that are going to be using the tape. How you?
Okay. Well, I started off being an agricultural nematologist. In other words, I would go out and find out what was the matter with somebody's crop if nematodes were involved. But soon thereafter, I moved into the field of ecology because we became very interested in why certain nematodes are some places and not others. So we would collect in stream areas. We would collect way back away from the stream, closer to the stream, and in the stream, and then use various techniques to calculate what kinds of nematodes were there and how the population changed as the ecology changed. And we did a lot of travel in those days so we could go to different locales. That we traveled very widely in Indiana, and we also traveled across the country stopping at interesting spots to make these collections. And our children were growing up then, and we discovered that each little child, if equipped with a knapsack, could hold 35 pounds of soil on its little back. And so we would collect these soil samples and load the kids up with them, and then some years later we wondered why neither of them wanted to go into science. But we used this little trailer, this travel trailer we had, and I had some lab equipment in there, and we lived in there and ate in there and slept in there and dragged it all over to all the state parks as far as the eye could see. And the kids learned to chop wood and do a lot of outdoor things. So that part of it was good. Yeah. So then, as we would bring back all these things, and I had a lot of students in those days. We shared our students. We began to run into things that we didn't recognize. We didn't know what they were. And it would turn out that they had not ever been described. So I went gradually into nematode systematics so that we could describe these things, which was a whole nother ballgame. So for some years, I had students that worked on taxonomic monographs. We had to keep the crops growing here in Indiana, I mean, as a sideline. That was always important because soybean cyst nematode was discovered along in there somewhere in Indiana, and that is the most important pest of soybeans. So we had to take care of soybean cyst nematode, no question about it. And we did other things too. Of course, we taught all through that period. But I spent quite some time with this nematode systematics business, and then along about the mid-80s, molecular biology began to come into the forefront of things. And it seemed to me that with molecular data, we could get a lot of answers that we couldn't get with the microscopes. And so for the first 10 years of this, before anybody here at Purdue was doing any molecular biology, I remember I wanted to jump right into DNA. And I took this up with some of the people in my department, and they said, "Oh, we don't do DNA. That's for people a lot smarter than us." So I worked with proteins instead of DNA for a while there, maybe about 10 years. But long about the late 80s, DNA research began to be something that I thought we could grasp. And so I began to teach myself what to do. And I began getting up at 3 in the morning so that I could read all of, you know, how to make a genomic library and all that, and try to do this stuff just out of the books. And there was one guy down in the basement of this building who is no longer with us, but he knew a little bit about this. So I would go take my protocols down there, and everything had to be miniaturized because all these protocols were written for larger animals, and they'd say, take 5 ounces of tissue. And so I had to miniaturize it because my little beasts are microscopic. They're just very, very little. And so miniaturizing all this stuff was a real challenge. But this moved on, and then in the late 80s, I got a National Science Foundation career advancement grant to learn how to do molecular stuff, and had a little money to work with. And however, through all that whole period, I'd had NSF grants rather consistently to do the kinds of things, first ecology and then the systematics and all this stuff. Is this ding-dong? I can turn off the email. Okay. So that was a big help. And so then after that, I've never looked back, and I've hardly looked through a microscope since, because we do everything. Everything's molecular now in my lab.
And then you have that breakthrough, that soybean line. That
yes, and as I say, all the whole time we were doing this, we were trying to look after the soybean system and throw it out in the soybeans. And so we teamed up with a geneticist too, with the Indiana Crop Improvement Association, and we did, by a combination of looking at the behavior of the plant when it has the nematodes on it, and some molecular markers, molecular data, we were able to pinpoint 4 loci in the soybean genome, and that were responsible for this, and that were responsible for resistance. In a particular resistant variety that was totally, completely resistant. So I guess probably by luck, but also by some very careful experiments, we were able to isolate some germplasm that had these 4 pieces of DNA in it, which the breeders can use to cross with their good, high-yielding lines. And that was patented and given to outfit called Access Technologies that leases it to breeders, and it's beginning to appear now in various lines of soybeans.
Good. Also, you know, switching gears a little bit, but the firm of action you were involved, you know, with some of the things that we were the first full professor in the School of Agriculture. Right?
Yes, I was, and I was also I had a spouse. And I may have to edit this out when I see it all done, but I remember one time a department head came to me and said, if anybody from the newspapers ever tries to interview you and John, I want you to send them away. Whenever the subject comes up that the two of you are both employed in one department, I just want to crawl under the table. So Purdue was not proud of having me here. They tolerated me, but
Well, you also were, you were the assistant dean in the grad school and also...
All right, now that was an interesting, yeah.
And also experience. The assistant provost.
Well, let me tell you how I got my job here in the first place, because all this relates back to that. Remember I told you I worked with that soybean breeder over in Illinois? Okay. And so when I came here, he continued to work with me. And he was a USDA person, and we decided to publish some of our stuff, do some published papers. And they had to be approved by the USDA moguls back in Washington, in Beltsville. And they said, what is he doing working with this woman out there? And so he wrote them back that there weren't any men to work with. I mean, I was it. There weren't that many nematologists kicking around loose. And so they said, well, this is terrible. We're going to have to put a man out there. So they established a station over there in Urbana-Champaign with a professor type to run it and trucks to drive and technical help to run errands, which meant that I was going to be out in the cold. And I just threw a fit. I mean, it made me so angry. And I was being replaced by a whole station over there. So I was raising such a fuss that they decided to throw me some kind of a sock. And so they put out one of these RFPs that they needed somebody to do a particular program and nematodes in the Midwest, blah, blah, blah. Pretty much tailored to me. And I could apply for it. And it was one of those things. If anybody else applied, I mean, heaven help them, because this was pretty much set for me. So, what do you know? I got this contract. It was a 3-year contract. But it was contingent on Purdue hiring me as an assistant professor. Okay. So, I went to our department head here and showed him this thing. And he said, oh, I can't hire you because of this nepotism thing, which he'd been using all along as the reason why he didn't. I said, okay. So anyway, I said I would take this contract to this other department, and then I would spend my time competing with entomology and my husband, that I was going to give them a run for their money. So within 24 hours, the nepotism rule had disappeared. And later on, I investigated it, and there really wasn't a rule per se. The rule is that you can't hire your relative, but my husband wasn't hiring me. So it evaporated, and that was probably good because there are a lot of women that got to be hired afterwards after I demolished the nepotism rule, which I was there anyway. So I came on. But this was for only half time. Hey. Okay. So I did this work for 3 years, and before the work was over, I got an NSF grant on my own. Must everybody surprised and shocked. And I was still paid half time. Okay. I was hired in 65. I was promoted to associate professor 5 years later in 1970. Still as a half time employee. I don't think this has ever happened before or since.
Probably not.
Because I told a provost one time when I was sitting on a committee, that I had been hired, given tenure when I was only being paid half time. He said, that is not possible. But nevertheless, it happened. Okay. And so, about that time, now mind you, I had tenure here in 1970. So, around, where's that CD I gave you? It was in the early 70s. Purdue suddenly realized it had no women in administration, and this became bad all of a sudden. why, I don't know. So in 1971, year after I got tenure, I was appointed assistant dean of the graduate school, which is not a real heavy job, but that was a big job because it was a woman. And the then dean of the graduate school was heard to say, women belong in the graduate school of the university, but not in my deanery. But he and I became very good friends, and although I was appointed originally for 3 years, I stayed on an extra year at his request. So that was good. And then right after that, I was asked to be an assistant provost for the same reason. And so after some bargaining back and forth, I agreed to do that too, mainly because I wanted to have the experience. I mean, I told him I didn't want to just be the woman provost and do affirmative action. Well, I wanted the whole schmear, just like the guys. They were hiring two other people. And so there was what they called their black, their woman, and their regular person. I've always thought was a riot, but the three of us got along really well, and so we traded jobs around, and that was a very interesting 3 year period. And during that period, I was promoted to full professor. But ladies, throughout this whole thing, I was still only paid half time, and a rationale for this was that the state doesn't like to pay two people in a family full-time salaries. So then after I finished this assistant provost thing, it was time to, I never left the department. I mean, I kept up with my research and teaching and all that all the way through. But when it was time for me to leave the provost office, they had to decide what to do about this. Was I going to return as a half-time person or as a full-time person? So I put on a full-court press to get a full-time position at that point. And a lot of things happened that I just do not remember, but the bottom line is that I was eventually hired as a full-time person. And so from that time on, I had been paid a real salary. I remember in the early days, the department head would call me in and say, now we've given you X amount of raise. Now, girl, go out there and find it. And that meant, you know, get a grant or something. Mm-hmm. It's not a good way to live.
Mm-hmm. You got, you've worked with students over time. How is it? Have you noticed any focus on their career goals or anything when you're interacting with the students?
Oh, yes, I do. Students are entirely different now. I mean, they consider themselves just fully professional, just like the women do, just like the men do. And I've actually enjoyed my teaching an awful lot. I've enjoyed it more in recent years than I have in earlier years. Students don't worry about how old you are as long as you have something interesting to tell them and to teach them. And I felt really quite liberated in front of my classes this last couple of years. We've had a wonderful time. I teach them molecular systematics and evolution, and they're very, very receptive, the men and the women.
Mm-hmm. Well, that Society of Hematology has given both you and your husband, you got some awards, didn't you, from that?
Yeah.
Most
of those are hanging on the wall.
Which is kind of nice.
I was the president of the Society of Hematologists really early in the game. Before I should. I don't have that one hanging here. That's over in my other office. I have another office over. I've only put up fairly recent ones here because I didn't want to scare off the younger folks that came in, you know. It was things up there with dates that are too old. They're trying to run away.
I see you got your Phi Beta Kappa. You've been really active in Phi Beta Kappa.
Yes, I was.
You became a member when you were
at Wellesley.
And then, but Purdue didn't get a chapter until 71, did
That's it? Correct. And I remember so well, this is another little anecdote. The national headquarters apparently sent Purdue a list of all of their faculty people who were members of Phi Beta Kappa when they started to organize their chapter.
The one at the chapter at Purdue.
Yes. Uh-huh. And so it came on a little postcard, and I got one of these, so I showed up on the appointed day, at the appointed hour, at the appointed venue, and walked in with my postcard in my hand, and the guy that was running this thing walked up and said, "Aren't you in the wrong place?" Well, they were all men. And
you were the only woman?
Yeah.
Oh, my Lord.
So I produced my postcard and said, "No, I don't think so." So I really had a lot of input. It runs my mind that we failed the first time. Hubby was the president of Purdue University at that time. We failed the first time, and we had to do it again. And I was fairly active and all that. And the fellow that was running this thing, it was kind of interesting because he eventually got used to me. And he eventually left Purdue and was applying for a job someplace else. And he had me write a letter of reference for him. Wasn't that the wheel coming full circle? So I held a number of offices in the, I was historian for a while, which is kind of an odd thing for me to be doing, but it was interesting, and then I became vice president and then president. And the important contribution to Phi Beta Kappa, though, was I was elected three six-year terms, they were long term, as a senator for the national Phi Beta Kappa. And that was where I got the most experience. I remember so well the first election, sometime in the 70s, but women were beginning to come to the forefront. And everybody was woman conscious. And there are a lot of Phi Beta Kappas out there who are women, because women tend to be smart. And so, so I was, my opponent in this election was the president of Wabash College. And I don't even remember why Purdue submitted my name. I guess nobody else was interested. But here I was on this ballot opposing the president of Wabash College, who was a splendid fellow, very famous, more famous than I'll ever be. And I thought, and various people and guys in the Purdue chapter said, "Well, I see you're running against this man." He said, "I think it's very nice of you to run, but I'm sure he's going to win, and I think he should win." And I don't know what the appropriate answer to that was, but I would just smile. Well, all these women out there who were voting and coming to these great triennial conferences, my God, they voted for the women. So this poor male president of Wabash College lost. Can you imagine?
They got up.
I was absolutely dumbfounded when they told me that I had won this election. But that was a wonderful experience. 6 times 3 is 18, so that's how many years I would
That's pretty good.
Go back to Washington, D.C. to these meetings.
Is that where their headquarters are? In Washington?
Yes. Yeah, okay. So I felt, and I met an awful lot of interesting people. Before this affirmative action thing took hold, the senators were all presidents of colleges, or very often they were people in the Congress there in Washington, D.C., or they were famous writers. They were head and shoulders above me. So I got to meet an awful lot of really interesting people.
Mm-hmm. Good context.
Oh, yeah. It was fun, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Looking at your roster there, is there any particular one that kind of sticks in your mind or a big surprise for any of the awards? I see you'd come.
Well, they were all a surprise.
Good.
I don't think
you got your patent up there. That's kind of good.
Is it up there? Oh, yeah. My mother got that for me. She
That's very
that
nice.
The
fellow is kind of a nice
Is that the one from the European Society? Yes, it is,
mm-hmm.
I believe.
And you also got the...
No, that one up there.
Yeah.
That was totally unexpected because they don't give those to women. And
very nice.
That was a huge surprise.
Very nice.
The very impressive gray thing with the metal in it.
Yes, I was going to ask
you
about that.
That's from the Phi Beta Kappas for the 18 years of service.
That's wonderful.
And I was chairman of committees, and I did quite a lot of stuff in that organization. And then the one underneath it was very gratifying. That's the team award from our College of Agriculture here for the SysTex thing. That was fun.
Very nice.
This little one right here, which doesn't have a gizmo, Valerie, pick it up and look at, no, the one that's staying on, look at the back of it there. It won't hang on my wall.
That's nice.
Yeah, but it won't hang on my wall, so that's the reason it's sitting there. But that was this Pioneer, Purdue Pioneer. That was a huge shock. There were 15 of those people, and only 5 of them were alive. The others were all dead.
Kind of can shake you up a little.
Well, there's a Phyllis McGinley poem that I can't remember exactly how it goes, but it ends up something along these lines. When all is done, this is said, I'm alive and they are dead, or something like that.
That's a new one.
Nice. That was just last spring. Yeah. I thought it was a very pretty
Yes, that's nice. Let's see. One of the things that I would comment, your the nematode collection, is that...
yes, it still exists. It's over in the other lab.
How do many people come? Do they use it here on campus? Or?
They used to. People aren't looking through microscopes much anymore. They're using molecular data. I think in time, molecular data will... I'm not sure that modern nematologists really know how to look through microscopes.
But it's an extensive collection, though, that you put together.
Yes, it's pretty. And we use it a lot for teaching.
Yeah, that's good.
But we still use it.
Yeah. You've had a couple of presidents during your tenure. Any comments on that? You had some ones. Dr. Hubby was president.
Yes, and I didn't know him at all. I was on the podium with him several times, particularly Phi Beta Kappa local function. Arthur Hansen was a good friend. We would meet on the street and he'd say, "Hi, Virginia, what are you reading?" And we would lend books. And he and Nancy had a picture framing set up in their basement. And they told me I could come over anytime I wanted. I mean, they had things where you could cut the corners and match your pictures and everything. So I went over a few times and worked in their workshop. And I knew Dr. Bering pretty well, too. But I've certainly met President Jiske back in the early days when SysTex was getting started. We talked some about that, but I don't know him well at all. Mm-hmm.
Is there some things that you'd like to, for the researchers, that you'd like to add on the tape, something I may have forgotten to ask or you want to share with us?
Well, there was, let me
see in your court,
what I've gotten down here. There was a number, this is not the first interview I've had. I guess everybody thinks maybe I'm going to die next week, so. I've been interviewed quite a number of times of late. And one of them was for a...
This had nothing to do with that. This is, we're getting, you're the one of our early ones for the oral history program.
Is that right? Okay.
Right.
Well, anyway, there was a, there's a book that was supposed to be being published by the American Cardiopathological Society about the women pioneers. Mm-hmm. And, again, most of them are dead. They are, I'm alive and they are dead. But there are a few living people in here. But a former graduate student of ours wrote this up, and it was a really nice thing. But I thought it just ended in such a nice way. He said, through a combination of her ability and knowledge, persistence and determination in the face of obstacles, adaptability to change, and taking advantage of available opportunities, Virginia Ferris has been able to follow her own career advice, quote, do what you enjoy doing. And I thought that was a really nice way to end, because that's about the size of it. There were a lot of obstacles, and there were times when I felt like giving up, but this is what I wanted to do.
And you persevered.
Yeah.
If I asked you, What is one of your longest memories of Purdue? Would you have any response to that Purdue University?
Me, my earliest?
No, or a special memory that since you've been at Purdue, because you most of your career life has been at Purdue.
Oh, yes. You're absolutely right.
Anything outstanding that sort of sticks in your mind that you'd like to share?
Oh, my goodness sakes. Well, the shock and awe when I was promoted both times.
That's very good. And there are more women on campus now.
Oh, gracious, yes.
So from that standpoint,
My goodness, that's been a sea change. And we have a woman who is the same woman dean of engineering in our place, which I never thought I'd live to see. And we have a woman provost. I mean, these are huge changes.
Exactly.
Yeah. Enormous. Yeah. Coming from the days when I was told to hide if a journalist came around.
That's interesting.
You know, Helen Schliemann had a huge effect on me. She was such a positive force. There were very few women I could talk to, but the dean of students' office, when Helen was there, and Bev Schliemann, Stone, and Barb Cook, and all those people, they would have a little dinner about once a month. And maybe you came to some of those, I don't know. And they would scoop up all of us. There were only, just a handful of faculty types on campus who were women. They would invite us to these, and it was a good time to network with these people. And Helen had these people over at her house all the time, and she'd say, you know, keep up the good work. And one of the very first things I did after I got tenure was to sit on a committee that Bev headed up to figure out how we could get more women students into the vet school. It was about 90% men and 10% women, and we just felt instinctively that the women had as good grades as the men. So we just really pushed on that one hard, and now it's 50-50, I guess.
Mm-hmm. As all the percentages have changed over time for women.
Yes, but in the vet school, it wasn't that women weren't applying. They had a quota. And it was about a 10%. That's all they wanted. Ah, I always feel, you know, like that was pretty useful. And I was on a couple of...
You served on a lot of committees.
Well, yeah, in those early days, as soon as Purdue figured out that affirmative action was here to stay, and discovered that all the committees were male, they had to have their woman. And there weren't that many women to choose from. And so I was just plunked on committee after committee after committee after committee. I spent almost all my time being on committees, and I now tell people that I did all my committee work then, you know, and so please excuse me from this committee today, because I did all that. I've been there, done that. But early on, I always take notes when I'm at a meeting, and for myself. They're very personal notes, you know, my impression of what's going on around it. So immediately these various chairmen would say, would you please be the secretary for our meeting? And so at first I did, and then I decided, well, nuts, they can take notes as well as I can. So I started saying no, and everybody had a fit at that. And then whenever there was a function that they wanted to do that involved food, they would say, would you plan this? And so, I don't like to plan functions that involve food any better than the next person. And so, I mean, it was all I did to get dinner on the table at night at home. So I would say, no, I don't think I can. So they have to appoint some mere male to do that. So a lot of that early committee work was kind of a matter of educating my fellow committee members. Crazy.
For the work of the committee. Any closing remarks, Virginia? Anything special?
I don't think so. I think I said it all. Probably way more than I should have said.
Oh, we really appreciate this. I think the sense of we really do.
I want to see that.
You'll get it.
Occasionally when I've given interviews, extensive interviews, and people have written them up, they fall into the hands of the administrators, and the administrators are like, we can't have this. So they...